like to welcome you all tonight. We didn't mean to have it set up like this. We kind of wanted to have sort of a roundtable feel to it, but it doesn't make easy filming that way. So if we feel a little like we're being too dictatorial up here, tell us that we're being too big for our britches and let us know, okay? But what we want to do is we want to get a feeling from all the boards and committees and from some of the departments and kind of sort of a building type issues and how they feel they will be interacting in the next years or so and how they want to interact in the next years or so with the public. So that's our goal tonight. We're going to start with the Municipal Building Committee, and they're going to give us an update on the buildings and where all the buildings are right now. And then we'll go through the boards and committees alphabetical first, and then we'll go to the town departments. So
5 minutes.
Up here, right?
Yes.
Okay. Hi, everyone. My name is David Tudor, and I'm the chairperson of the Municipal Buildings Committee. Thank you for coming tonight. I want to try and keep this informal, too, so I'll encourage my committee members to stand up, and you know, if there's some aspect of this plan that I miss, please jump in as well. So I'll be brief. I think probably most of you now know about us, and hopefully many of you have seen our meetings live. I wish you would more of you would come to our meetings, in fact, but we're happy to have you here tonight. A little bit about what we've been doing as a committee over the last couple of years. Everyone hear me okay? No problem. Good. You know, initially when we started, our mandate was to decide building by building whether we were going to keep the building, renovate the building significantly, or build a new building, or demolish the building. So it was essentially looking at all the individual buildings from that aspect. So our first mandate, of course, was to look at the buildings, do actual tours, and we did that at the onset. We spent a couple of weekends going through each of the facilities, getting some indications of what some of the issues are of the structures and looking at that. We recognize that there are a couple of extra reports that have been done prior to us, so we studied those reports and discussed some of the priorities that were put out there. We conducted department interviews. We tried to get each of the department heads to come to meet us and discuss what specifically their needs were. Then we conducted a survey of the departments, which you all had gotten last year. We actually also completed site surveys, so we have site plans of all the town's buildings. And lastly, we hired a task-based general engineer, a consulting firm, an AE firm, architectural engineering firm, to look at the structures and the code analysis of some of our historic properties, because the seismic implications for these properties is fairly significant. So after that analysis, you know, it came to be that we made a recommendation, many recommendations pertaining to the critical needs of the facilities. So first, do no harm, ensure the longevity of the building. So we went and we made the fixes we needed to make to keep the buildings up for the next foreseeable future anyway. Back to our recommendations, the mandate by the select board. The recommendations are basically based on two factors. The first being the existing and the longer term department needs, as well as existing space constraints where they currently are housed. And the second is the actual building conditions. So taking all this into consideration, meeting with the departments, getting a good look at the buildings, we started to develop some recommendation plans and understand that one recommendation plan might have impacts on other buildings and other departments. So it's fairly complex in terms of workflow. The first seems somewhat obvious. The Village Hall in North Hadley is in need of significant repairs and code issues for long-term arose, and so we made an initial recommendation to sell that property, and that was approved by town meeting. Of course, that With that comes the necessity to rehouse the Park and Rec Department, which, you know, currently has issues with the space needs there, and they'll go over that in their presentation. And of course, the North Hadley Fire Substation, which as a committee, we've recommended be replaced in kind to maintain the services in North Hadley Village. That's been a subject of discussion over the last year. There's been many presentations by the chief about that, and I think the general consensus is that there is some form of facility needed to properly serve the residents of the town. But we can discuss that later as well. So those two implications. And then we looked at the next priority after we look at Village Hall as a building is the department, the senior center department, or the senior center itself, recognizing that the building itself has a short-term function as a swing space. It's not in terrible shape, but honestly, additional upgrades are not realistic in that facility. And so we know that the growing senior population in town is a priority, and we want to take care of our seniors. Looking at the condition of that building, we recognize that there's not a lot we can do for that building without spending a lot of extra money on it. So that is a priority as well. And the accessibility issues there are also a concern. So looking at the Park and Rec needs, for either a lease space or some space outside of their existing location at the senior center, I mean at the Village Hall, we've considered a cohabitation of a community center, and that's been a discussion and something that we haven't really worked out whether that's a possibility or not. But those two departments obviously will need space in the short to moderate term. Doing okay? Any issues so far? Anything to add, gentlemen? Okay, we'll keep going. Beyond the senior center, our next priority so far has been the public safety complex, recognizing that there's some short-term repairs we've already taken care of, but there's some more middle-range to longer-term repairs or additions or embellishments to that building that are necessary to take care of the needs of the two departments, police and fire. So the problem with those recommendations and the reason that building hasn't advanced any farther at this time is a series of decisions that need to be made by the town pertaining to whether we're going to have an ambulance service that occupies that site as well as police and fire. Whether we're going to have full-time firefighting in that facility, which would mean we'd have to build dormitories and other services for those firemen. And then actually whether North Hadley Village Hall or North Hadley's fire substation is built, and if not, then what can we do to the existing public safety complex to add for capacity? So those are a few decisions that are kind of holding us back from making a real formal determination on that building. Now, that building presents two concepts within our committee that we've considered. The first is that the public safety complex has a lot of shortcomings in terms of the type of building that we built 18 or 19 years ago. Had we had to do it again, we'd build it much differently. Recognizing that, there's been some conversation about the possibility of building a new public safety complex to more appropriately accommodate the needs of those two departments and repurpose that facility for the senior center and for Park and Rec as essentially a community center. That's option one. The other option is to take the site as it exists today and the building as it exists today and make an addition or make some modifications to that building that'll, you know, assist the programmatic needs of the departments. So those are two kind of discussions within our committee that we've talked about. In terms of building a new fire substation, there's some schedule impacts that would have to be, you know, looked at a little further, and so that's a serious consideration. And so as we've gone through these, what we're starting to realize is that there's a pretty significant need for acquisition of land for some of these extra buildings. If in fact we're going to build a new community center, You know, we're in favor of a campus plan, which could mean something on the Hooker School Senior Center property, but the site's not quite large enough to house that, plus the library's plans, as you'll hear about tonight. If we were to build a new fire station in North Hadley, we would have to find a property for that as well. So site acquisition or property acquisition is one of our main priorities at this time. Moving on to the other buildings, and I will get to the library, but the DPW, we recognize that there are some space constraints there, particularly accommodating the a future enlarged sewer facility. So we don't quite understand what the needs of the sewer department is in terms of space, and I'm not sure that anyone can tell us exactly how much more of the DPW site they need, but that is a concern. We recognize that there's some very old trailers that are used for offices there that need to be replaced. We recognize that. That's a short-term repair or replacement. And we've also talked about a vehicle wash bay as a possibility, because currently our equipment's coming in with sand and salt on it. There's no way to wash it down and preserve it so it doesn't rust out, and that could be used by multiple departments. So that's another recommendation we had come up with. The town hall, the town hall has some short-term preservation accomplished. We've done a good job of keeping the building up, so you know that'll be good for the short term. We do have to address the expansion needs of all the departments that are inside of that building, and part of the solution to that may or may not be Russell School. So we're looking at how we could repurpose the Russell School facility, whether we could use it for offices. We're doing some studies on the structure, trying to determine some other factors that could make that a usable space for other departments. And of course, the senior center doesn't just house the senior center. There's additional departments in there that are gonna need space. If we do something with that facility, they've either gotta come to one of the new facilities we build or Russell School or somewhere else. So we haven't quite figured that one out either. And now back to the library. Initially, we saw the library as, well, the trustees have been a great steward to that facility, and as such, it's in wonderful shape. So it hadn't really been on our radar as something that needs to get addressed immediately. That didn't really take into account the space needs that they have for the library and the shortage of space that they currently have, so that is a factor. The library trustees and their building committee has been very active coming to our meetings and expressing what exactly they're doing in terms of the design and the phasing of all their plans and grants. And so that's gone pretty well. But it took us for a little bit of a surprise when we better understood the schedule for the grants and how that might advance in front of some of our other priorities. As I said, as a committee, it wasn't on the top, but that's something that we now have to address. When we were asked which sites were good sites for the library, we did identify Russell School, we identified the property behind the senior center, and frankly, we identified the senior center because, not understanding quite exactly what the schedule would permit, we did understand that building in the long run would need so much work that it's not realistic to make serious improvements to it. So essentially, that's the last 2 years of the building committee. We're working on the recommendation plans to more formalize them, and working with the individual departments to better understand what we can do in the future. We welcome you all to come to our meetings and give us your input. We're meeting bi-weekly at this time, so Tuesday nights at 7 o'clock. Any questions? Yes, sir.
Just a point of clarity. John Edwards, I'm a resident of Hawk Meadow Drive. The Russell School is the current senior center, is that correct?
No, the Russell School is the unoccupied facility that was at the North Star School. Right. We recognize that, well, I'm an architect, so I put a lot of value into that building. I think it's a gorgeous building, and it is an anchor for our community center. So I think it's an important feature, and most of us would like to preserve that as a town building, but we need to get a better handle on the construction cost for improving it, and we think it's gonna be significant, quite honestly.
great.
Thank you.
Sure.
All right, so we kind of made a list of who we thought was here. I'm going to run through it really quick, and then we'll start. So the assessors?
They're meeting right now.
All right. Is there someone from conservation that wants to? Council on Aging is not here. I don't see them.
They're here.
Yeah, we are.
Oh, there you go.
I think conservation's resting up from last night.
Yeah, I think so, too. They need it. Did the FinCom, the Finance Committee want to speak, or are you just here to listen? Okay. Historic Commission, I think I saw them walk in. What?
Some of the departments in the town hall wanted me to speak on their behalf.
No. We're going to let the boards and committees go first, and then we're going to let the town departments go next. So you'll get your chance then. Is that, that's kind of how we laid it out.
You're trying to get a feel for who's going to speak.
Yeah, I just want to know who's talking.
Going through the list now to find out who's going to speak.
All right, library, they didn't want to talk at all. Park and Rec?
Yeah.
Did you wish to, yes? Okay. Planning Board?
Only if you want to say something.
You just want, okay.
Good question for us, but other than that.
You know, the other thing that's good about a town or this type of meeting is even if you just took a couple minutes, I know you guys had a big meeting this week and about little houses, if you could update people like that. One of the other reasons regarding having this meeting is even if it wasn't specifically towards that, one of the things in our SWOT analysis that we were doing, we found that there was it would be better if we had a better communication amongst the boards. I don't think you're going to have another venue like this, so.
Okay, and School Committee. So did I miss anybody, one of the committees that wants to, committees or boards? Okay, so for town departments, I have building inspections and the rest of town hall. I have fire, police, public works, treasurer. Okay.
Town clerk.
Anybody here from CPA?
Town clerk.
That's probably Timmy's probably.
Yeah. Right,
so did I miss any board committee that wants to speak?
CPA here?
Yeah, I was going
to
say CPA. No.
Nope.
No CPA.
All right, so that means that the Council on Aging gets the lead off. So the way we set this up is, well, we'll set it with 5 minutes, but if you go a little over, don't go over 10. I apologize for the shortness. We're trying to fit everybody in. Didn't they tell you that's the biggest part of your job?
Oh, it's fabulous. So I'm Suzanne Travisano. I'm the director of the Council on Aging. And my 5 minutes, let's see. So in case you are not aware, the Council on Aging's overarching goal is to improve the quality of life of Hadley's residents that are 60 or older, even maybe a little bit before that, by offering the tools to remain independent within their own community, by offering healthy aging programs, services, education, and social interaction. It's our task to identify, as well as yours, to let us know what your needs are, and to develop and promote services to meet those needs. We also serve as advocates for the elders and try to educate the community at large, like I'm doing right now, about those needs and the available resources. So I'm going to go into how we do that. How do we do that? So we do a lot of human service work insofar as health outreach. I've been recently asked for a lot of figures on how to do that. We don't have a lot of staffing, so we play catch as catch can. I don't have unduplicated counts, but I certainly do have duplicated counts for a lot of what we do, and I think some of them might be surprising. From January to December of this past year, between the hours of 9 and 2, we took 2,232 phone calls from seniors. We had 965 people walk in asking questions that we helped on a person-to-person basis. Of all the 7 exercise classes that we offer, they were attended 3,064 times. Our exercise equipment that we moved into that other room was used 298 times. The nurses' office hours that are every Wednesday morning between 8 and noon were visited 356 times. We had a foot clinic that was attended 69 times. We had 39 SHINE appointments, which is helping people with their health insurance, Medicare insurance, issues that they might have. We served 13 people for fuel assistance over 29 visits. We passed out 264 brown bags of groceries to 22 people, duplicated counts. We had 44 people attend 114 times to the outreach office hours that we offer at Winfield Estates and Golden Court over the year. We had 334 times people went shopping, and the unduplicated count for that was 23 people. We did 56 taxes. Unrelated to us, but part of our front door when people call to say, my mother needs Meals on Wheels, or I'd like to get Meals on Wheels, how do I do that? And we direct them to that. In 2004, for the total year, Meals on Wheels deliveries, some of which are our volunteers, over 7,320 meals were delivered in Hadley. So I don't know if you're all familiar that that's all the work that goes on there besides the events that haven't even been tallied, like special events, presentations, classes like the computer class, the Spanish class, any other education that we do. So we're a busy place, and we haven't totally gotten our stats up, but I hope that gives you a better idea. I know you were asking for figures, and we've been working hard to play catch up to do that because we're down an office person. We also have veterans office hours that I don't have a tally from. Yeah, and like I said, all our trips, our leisure trips and things like that, we haven't even begun to formulate those statistics. So that's the kind of work we do, but we also try and engage people socially. And we make phone calls to do that. We invite them to special events. And I'm fortunate enough to get feedback from them that that's really meaningful to them, and they miss doing that, and we invite them back. And that's what makes my job. That's why I do my job. That's what makes it worthwhile for me. So then I believe the next question that you wanted answered was, what do I need in an environment to do that job? Is that correct? I didn't bring my agenda up here.
Yes, that's...
All right, so currently we've had to call people over the last week that use walkers and can't come down the stairs for congregate meal or other things that are happening because our elevator has been out of order since Monday. We don't have air conditioning in the summer, so we scale everything way back. And we don't have adequate heating down the end of the east side of the building upstairs to run classes. This morning for Spanish, we use space heaters. We don't have what should be our offices downstairs in the center of the activity so that we can really keep a watch on people that are in the new exercise room or doing exercise period where the AED is. The upstairs bathrooms are still styled in elementary school height appropriate, which is a challenge.
Makes you feel young.
You think? Try, no, don't go there. Okay.
Let's not go there. Understood.
Understood, yeah. So, and coupled with the fact that, you know, it's not a homey environment for people that are leaving their homes to come and be with others. It's cold. It's cold feeling. It's cold looking. And it's not user-friendly, especially when the elevator's not working. We're not saying we don't have enough space. We have plenty of space. We don't use all the space that's in there. That's not the issue. It's just fitting a square peg in a round hole.
Suzanne, can you address the need for a kitchen area? Is that a necessity, or is that a want versus a need?
Okay, I'm going to say that it's a need because, well, A, because we absolutely need the refrigerator, we need the dishwasher for big functions, we have steam tables because we get the meals delivered to us, which is great, but in the future, things could change because that state and federal funding for those particular meal programs has always been a dwindling resource. And also another thing that you really want to be cognizant about looking into the future is that we're going to have a lot more people to take care of in a daily basis, that I see it would be wise for senior centers, if it's possible, to start incorporating in the next 5 or 10 years, if possible, some adult daycare in there as well, because those are few and far between, booked to the maximum, and you're going to have less and less children available to take care of this rising population of seniors. So if they want to stay at home, a really good thing to look into is how you can have some of those pieces there, and you need a kitchen for that.
Okay, thank you.
You still have a waiting list for the Meals on Wheels?
I keep on them.
Okay.
Thank you.
Do I need to ask a question?
No, we'll take questions at the end.
Thanks, Suzanne.
The assessors are here.
Assessors back, but that's not up.
Oh, yeah, that's right. All right, this is the Historical Commission.
Hi, Ginger.
I did, thank you.
I didn't.
Hi, I'm Ginger Gold. Is this on?
Should be.
I'm Ginger Goldsberry, Chair of the Historical Commission. The Historical Commission's mission, as dictated by the Mass Historical Commission, is to assist the towns in preservation and restoration of all historical assets. That includes buildings, particularly buildings and landscapes. So that's our primary mission in town. So this year, in the last couple of years, we have spent time we hired Old Mohawk, you may remember, we hired them to do some assessment of...
That's actually not on Ginger because he was getting too much feedback.
I didn't think it was on. No. Well, can you hear me?
Yes.
No?
Front row can.
Can you hear me? You know, I don't speak very loud, so...
You can walk around if you want.
I don't...
Okay, Ginger, you're back live.
I'm back live. Thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. A couple of years ago, we hired Old Mohawk to do some assessment of the buildings we could afford to have them assess. And we only had our CPA money, which was $33,000, and we used that. And they assessed the North Hadley Village Hall and a little bit of Town Hall and Russell School. And so that is part of what the building committee used for their assessment of our buildings. And the town voted to sell North Hadley Village Hall with a preservation restriction, which makes some of us in North Hadley very sad. Some people in North Hadley are happy. But regardless of that, that's the decision that's been made. Now, the preservation restriction has been put together by the, first we hired Tom Paskey to make a list of all the parts of the Village Hall which needed to be included in the preservation restriction. So he did that, and that information was given to the Pioneer Valley Planning Commission. They put together the restriction, which was then sent to Mass Historical Commission for their approval. And that is where it is now, and it has been there since well before Thanksgiving. So we just have to wait for them to finish it and send it back. I have sent a copy to, if any, I mean, I don't know if I sent a copy to the building committee. Did I send you that restriction? I would have emailed. Okay. So it's pretty straightforward. There's not a lot of change that I think will be made, but I think then you'll at least have it to look at, and we can talk about that. We were hoping that the North Hadley Village Hall restriction would be separate from the lot that's adjacent to the school, to the hall. And apparently it's one deed, and so the preservation restriction is for the building, the lot is separate, and if we wanted to restrict that in any way, it has to be a separate deed. So I don't, that's something we can talk about at some point. So that's been a big part of what we've been working with the last year. We are also concerned about all the historic buildings in town, and it's very sad to me personally. I'm on the Historic Commission because my family were initial settlers of a very small village in north of here, and I find these old historic buildings beautiful and valuable, and the town hasn't put money into them for many, many years, and as a result, our beautiful old buildings are falling apart. And so there doesn't seem to be the money, and money is an issue, and I get it, but there doesn't seem to be the money nor the will to find money to preserve them. So that, for me, that's my own I think that I speak for most of the Historical Commission. We would like to see them all preserved. We know we can't save everything, but these buildings have are the history of the town. And so we need to know really what the town wants to preserve. And if the answer is nothing, then that's important to us for us to know, because we spend a lot of energy trying to save them. But if that's not what people want, if you just want to tear them all down and build all new ones, I guess we need to know that as well. I don't mean to be snide, but I do need to know, we do need to know if that's what the majority of people in town want. Let's see. We are, as a result of all of this, we're also involved with the DPW. They are going to expand Route 9, and so we are concerned about the impact of that kind of expansion on particularly the library, because that's the part of Route 9 that's going to be expanded. And they say it's not going to have any impact on the library, but I'm not convinced, because if you sit in town hall and the trucks go by, everything shakes, and the same will happen to the library, I'm sure. No matter what anybody says, that's what I believe, not being professional. So that is something that we are very concerned with, and we're involved with them in all of their, in their talks as well. We want to point out that we are also, that we also have this CPA money. We get a historic set aside that we can use for historic preservation and restriction, and preservation and restoration. So these buildings that need work, we don't get much, but we are willing to use our money, our $30,000 for restoration and preservation, which isn't much in grand scheme of things. But there is a lot of CPA money that can be used for preservation of buildings that we have. And lastly, one little thing we do, it seems to take up a fair amount of our time, is we provide, the planning board sends us developers with plans that are in the historical district to make sure that they are in line with what we expect from them. So we do that as a favor, although I think it's become part of our job, and we don't really mind. It's sort of fun to know what's going on. And I think that's it. Anybody else?
Any openings on your board, Ginger?
There are openings on the board. There are always openings on the board, and there may be more after this. You might kick me right off. No, there are openings on the board. We do in fact need, you started that. We do in fact need people on the Historical Commission who are not only interested in what is going on with our historic resources, but who have some experience and knowledge to help us along. So we need architects, we need somebody who can speak instead of me. You know, we need people who are intelligent, who have some energy, and can get involved with the town and do some interesting work. It's not a lot of work, but we need help. Thank you, Jerry.
Thank you. Thank you. Library?
Hello.
Hey, Patrick.
So my name is Patrick Brezzo. I'm the director of the library. I think we have most of the trustees here as well. If I am missing something, please just shout out that I'm missing something. I have, like Suzanne, a number of facts and figures about the library, about what we do there, how busy we are. So I'm going to go through those. If you have a question about those, just stop me. But before I start with those, I just wanted to say that I think it's really important, and I want everyone here to know, and I think everyone who is a trustee or a member of the Planning and Design Committee, I think we all want you to know that you are welcome to come into the library, to look around, to ask questions. We would be happy for you to see what we do in the library, what kind of a service we provide, and under what sorts of conditions that we provide those under, because we are very challenged, and that's why I think, you know, quite possibly we're all here tonight in one room. So the first thing I want to say and remind people of, and most everyone probably knows a lot of these facts, but I'm going to say them again anyways because they're important, is that the library is 113 years old. 113 years old is, that's a long time. And the building has not been renovated in any significant way, really, in that time, in any way that would really improve or modify service. So that's a challenge for us. The other thing that is important to remember is that Hadley has changed a lot in that 113 years. The library was constructed in 1902 when the population of this town was roughly 1,800. So we're now three times as big, but we're still using the same library. When that library was designed, it was intended that all of the library services that were provided would be on the main floor that you walk into now. We've long since outgrown that space. We've moved into the basement, which was never intended to be a functional library space. It's not accessible. There's no elevator in that building. The restrooms are downstairs. That's a challenge for many people. We have an upstairs that was not designed for library use. It was intended as an assembly hall. At this point, we're restricted in what we can use it for. We use it for office space. People take their lunch up there. But essentially, it's a beautiful space that the public cannot enjoy, cannot use, because it is not accessible. The bottom line fact is that this library cannot provide adequate service to a population that within 20 years is going to grow to possibly 6,500 people. The building was built when the town had 1,800. It's just a fact. The other bottom line is that we serve everyone of every age. We are uniquely providing service to a community, every member of that community. So unlike some of the departments that, you know, have a focus, we are open to everyone and have to provide for everyone equally and adequately. And so we're very challenged to do that. And not only that, but this is, it's truly a community space where all are welcome, all gather. You know, you check in with your neighbors, you read, you spend time. And it's important to remember that. I'll give you a few numbers. I'll try not to bore you with those. One of the most important numbers is about people entering that space. We, in the calendar year 2015, had 18,590 patron visits. That's a lot of people. In fiscal year 2015, we circulated 46,000 items. Only 9% of that was electronic items. So when people say, you know, who uses this? You know, you can just go download a book. Well, only 9% of that was, and we provide those services, but only 9% of what we did was that kind of activity. So people are coming in and checking out real things. This is not, you know, this is not the something from the past. This is something that people currently use, and in greater and greater numbers. And we're getting busier all the time, not less. In FY 2015, we had 2,296 people attend programs at the library. We're open 33 hours a week, 6 days per week. We have one full-time staff person and six part-time staff working a range of 6 to 27 hours per week. We've got 20,000 physical items crammed into that building, and essentially for every item that comes into the building, one has to be taken out. There's no room for more collections. It's just a matter of switching out what we have. Skip those numbers. And so I just thought I would recap for a moment the planning and design process that we've been going through for the last couple of years, just to get people up to speed. We want people to understand what we've been up to and how that's been working out, and then also to give you a glimpse into what's coming for us, what our timeline looks like for the next couple of years. And then we have also some designs here, which we may or may not have time to look at. No, we don't have time to look at them, so we'll skip that. But we do, at every iteration of this design process, we do try to keep the designs on display. So if you'd like, please come into the library, see the designs, ask questions. We're happy for you to do that. So I'm just going to run through this very quickly. Much of this, again, you will already be aware of. So in May of 2014, town meeting voted unanimously to support the library in pursuit of a planning and design grant from the Mass Library Commissioners. Town meeting further supported the appropriation of $25,000 from CPA for the planning and design process. We received that grant in spring of 2014. That was a total of $75,000 that we had to work with and are working with. With those funds, the Planning and Design Committee was formed, including members of the public, staff, select board, municipal building committee. The committee completed a detailed building program which examines the current library relative to the services that we provide, as well as a needs assessment for providing services 20 years into the future. And if you have not looked at that, we've distributed it in print. It's also available online at the library's website. I would really encourage you to read it because it has all of the information there for why we're doing what we're doing. David Tudrin mentioned, the Municipal Building Committee gave us the set of sites to examine. The whole committee made a decision about the best potential site, which ended up being the former Hooker School, currently the Senior Center. And we felt that we were making the best decision transparently and with the information that was given to us to work with. In the spring and summer of 2015, we hired our owner's project manager, D.A. Sullivan of Northampton, and architect Johnson Roberts Associates of Somerville. And they are working with us currently to provide the plans that we're not going to look at tonight. So the timeline going forward, if anyone from the this is where we are over here. Of course, what we're looking for next is for the town to give another vote of support, public support, for us to pursue
construction funding from the Mass Board of Library Commissioners. That would be potentially much, or maybe even slightly more than 50% of the total construction cost for a new library. We don't have a figure, we can't tell you half of what, we can only say that it could be half of X number of dollars. We have a very conservative design relative to the size of the community that we're serving. We've tried to be as frugal as possible while still having a viable library that can provide service adequately. The other votes that we'll be looking for there are for an approval. We're looking for the authority to actually build on the site that has been selected. We need to know that legally we have the ability to do that. So that will have to be decided at that vote, at that meeting as well. And also to approve the design, at that preliminary design at that point as it stands when we get to town meeting. After that, in January 2017, that's the actual due date for the grant application for construction funds. We'll be working on that in the meantime. July 2017, those grants were awarded. As I said, we could be looking at as much as 50% of the construction costs granted to us. We'll also be looking to raise funds privately, and the rest will have to come from municipal appropriations. Fall 2017, we have a town vote and grant acceptance. At that point, we'll know what the cost is going to be for the balance of the library construction, and the town will vote for that. And in spring 2019, at the earliest, is when construction could begin.
Is that it? You're a little over.
What's that?
You're a little over.
Thank you.
Can you wrap up?
I'm done.
Oh, cool. Sorry.
All right.
Thank you.
Sure.
People are still here, and I don't get the buzz.
If everybody stays within the 5 to 10 minute range, we'll have plenty of time for everybody to ask questions and have more open discussion and try to link these things together, you know, because the library said something that affects the senior centers, and we'll hopefully get that conversation going as soon as everybody's gone through and said something. So if you would please kind of try to stay to the 5 to 10 minutes. So the next group up is Park and Rec. Did Park and Rec want to say something?
He's making a run for it.
I was going
to take that five minute break. I should try to catch everybody when they're trying to put something there, and then they'll go faster.
All right, so
I will admit you caught me a little off guard. I'm Andy Klepacki, one of the Park and Rec commissioners. Can you hear me? Is it on? Okay. I thought this was going to be a roundtable discussion, so if you saw me scribbling furiously, it was a realization that I might have to stand up and say something. Certainly, thank you, Richard. Now I know it's on. It's not hard to imagine what the goal of the Park and Rec Department is: to provide programs and services for recreational and educational. Back away?
Yep,
okay. Am I too close? Is that better? Thank you for that. Okay, so it's not too hard to figure out what our program's about, offering these recreation programs and activities for all residents in town. It's not strictly, we're not strictly youth athletics. We do a fair amount have a great diversity of programs, and I thank our program coordinator, Kathy Zaterka, for being able to constantly pursue a variety of programs besides the staples that are youth athletics. And we also recognize that in this the squeeze here, you know, that it's not necessarily an essential service, but I'd like you to take a moment to raise your hand if you, your children, or your grandchildren have participated in Hadley Park and Rec programs. Anybody? So we may not be an essential service, but we have a very broad application in town. We've been housed in North Hadley Hall pretty much since the early 90s. and actually predating that occupation of the building, the building committee back in the early 80s was also tasked what to do with that building, perhaps even divest in it. So it's been a building that has received really no significant upgrades, at least since we've been there. I know there was one done to expand the fire station, the front end of that, to be able to house things. And of course, we're up against that issue again with our neighbors that we occupy the building with. The condition of the building, anybody's driven by, I don't have to get into great detail about it. I mean, there's been issues over the years where possible closing down of the building because of pigeon waste contamination, and there's been, we've come to the brink before with other services where we've almost been shut down because of the condition of the building. And it's been an issue so much that the department's been asked to speak to the select board, and we've been doing that since 2011. Am I fading out here? Is it a little bit? Okay. So we've been before the board at least three times, presenting over that time what our space needs are. So I'm not going to go into great detail about square footages and numbers of activity rooms and storage and all that. We'll keep that for later review. But suffice it to say that in that time, the discussions about North Hadley Hall, it's been hard to prop up our programs because people are saying, "What? I don't want to send my kid up there." You know, there's been talk about putting Park and Rec over in Russell School. Well, if it isn't good enough for our tenants, why should we send the kids to Hadley into a building like that? So it's an interesting conundrum, what to do. Right now, pretty much every department has a place to occupy and exist. The town has voted to sell North Hadley Hall. Where are we going to do business? Senior Center has been brought up as a possible alternative in the short term for swing space. Actually, Park and Rec was there for a short time a couple years ago. The building doesn't adequately meet the needs of the Senior Center. So I think Susan said square peg in a round hole. Well, adding Park and Rec only exacerbates that situation. And let's see if I can read my own writing here. And that's not even going into discussion about the parks part of the equation here for the Park and Rec Department, where we have, basically, you've got the Zaterka Park, which has been an issue ongoing because it was built on a stump dump, and there's, you know, there's always a money issue of how we can repair that, and we're actually undergoing discussions with a volunteer group to see if we can revitalize that park and put it back into something that the town could be proud of. There's the North Hadley Park right next to North Hadley Hall, and of course with the building for sale, and we don't know what the potential is for hanging on to a piece of that for at least access to Lake Warner, but it really won't constitute much of a park. I don't know if any of you have driven by it during the summertime when we have our youth programs that are up there, when we can be outside and using it. It's pretty much, we're booked all summer long with programs up there. Where do we run our programs? Well, we used to run a lot more at North Hadley Hall when before issues with the building have prevented us from either, you know, fire safety, occupancy issues. We've had to scale back on what we can actually run in that facility. So that looks to outside of the buildings. Of course, we're involved at the school. We have a good cooperative relationship with the school. The school has, but you know, one of the issues we face is the accessibility. They've got programs going on in the afternoon, you know, the after school program. So we take advantage of it in the narrow slots that we can, but you know, given all the pressures on the schools to what they can do for security issues and accessibility, there's just, that's not a great resource long term for us to consider to continue to use. Plus, there's a lot of things you'd like to do where you don't have to set it up in an hour and take it all out in an hour, and that's and like a sewing class or actually a cooking class, those types of things can't adequately be done in the school. And if they were in the past, pretty much not much anymore. And we appreciate the access, and we do what we can to cooperate, but know, opportunities are limited. So one of the longer-term considerations of the department has been to recommend considering a community center. Why a community center? Well, first of all, it actually adds services and programs and space to the town that we don't have. We're not just swapping out, you know, an old building for a new building. We're looking at adding additional activities, programs. I mean, we've been able to fill up and book up the space that we have. If we have a larger space, we can certainly do something like that. But you get a community center where we might have disparate meeting rooms and activity spaces and all these different buildings all over town. Well, if we bring them together, we're going to bring the townsfolks together. We can bring some of the people together. The kids don't have a place to go after school unless they're enrolled in a program. We're running a Zumba class upstairs in North Hadley Hall. We could run more of those activities, more youth activities, more adult activities, if we had the space to do it. Community center could also double for voting and for town meeting and the like. So it's something that, you know, I think you should consider, that it actually adds value and adds programs that the town doesn't currently offer. So in summary, certainly we'd like to have a place to continue to operate in the fall once this building, once North Hadley Hall situation is resolved. We can go into further detail again with the boards as to what exactly our space needs are. And again, sorry, I'm a little disjointed, but I look forward to more round table discussions.
Thank you. Thank you. Thanks. The planning board?
Jim Axum, which one's working? Both of them?
Right.
They're both working, okay. Anyways, Jim Axwoski and the planning board, we're a 5-member elected board. Each position serves 5 years, re-elected once every 5 years. Anyways, what we do, we are essentially the caretakers of the zoning bylaws. And I'm sure most people know the building inspector is the enforcer of the zoning bylaws as the zoning enforcement officer. We do stuff like, you know, upgrade the zoning bylaws, hold site plan hearings, public meetings, stuff like that, all regarding zoning. Some of the things that have occurred in the past year that have really been significant to us, we've got the first senior housing application. We passed a senior housing bylaw, I know it's got to be at least 6-7 years ago now, and we got the first application just this past fall, had the first couple of public hearings. It's been continued, and for all intents and purposes, it'll probably be approved with some conditions and stuff like that. But that's the one's going to be on East Street, essentially behind the post office. No, I'm sorry, behind the professional building. Okay, behind the professional building that's on the corner of East Street and Route 9. It's going to be up to 64. Bedrooms or about 35 buildings between, you know, they want to sell the building, but it'll only be for seniors 55 and older. We've also are updating the master plan. That's over 10 years old, to keep the master plan up and according to state law or state rules, maybe it's a better way. It has to be upgraded about every 10 years. We're working on that with the Pioneer Valley Planning Commission. We got a application from 5 colleges to essentially build a book storage building off of North Maple Street. That was not approved by the planning board, and that is currently under litigation with the developer. I can't say more than that right now because of that. And just as a recent thing, it's getting a lot of publicity. How big of an issue it is, we don't know yet, but it's the tiny house issue. I don't mean to say tiny house has anything to do with zoning, because zoning cannot regulate or control the size of the building. That's a building code issue. The zoning enforcement officer gave basically a cease and desist order to the lady that was living on this house on East Street, as basically it was a detached or unattached two residences on the same lot, which according to the Hadley zoning bylaws is not allowed. They appealed his decision to the ZBA. The ZBA held a public hearing Monday evening. They upheld the zoning enforcement officer's decision. However, they gave her a stay until the day after town meeting, which is May 5th. And so on May 6th, she is proposing to put a article on this annual town meeting to allow said use. We don't even know what the article is going to look like. She is drawing it up. We'll have to wait and see, but she wants to get it onto this town meeting, and the town meeting people can make a decision as to whether it's a good idea or bad idea at that point in time. What we need for our planning board room is pretty basic. We need a space to store our multitude of filing cabinets. We have about 20 of them. And we need ready access to that because at any point in time, not frequently, but you know, several times a year, people will come in or a planning board meeting will be held and people will say, what about this? What about this decision? So it's not something we can archive the files. We have a bunch of drawings, and we need a meeting room where we meet every week that'll hold anywhere from probably 25 to 50 people. If we have a special large meeting, we can have it in one of the other municipal buildings, but we routinely will get 15 to 20 people at a meeting.
You were talking about setting up an educational seminar to help shepherd people through the planning process.
Yeah, we were looking at different ways to inform townspeople of what's going on in town. And I think one of the good ideas we had at one of our last planning board meetings is we have public hearings probably almost once to twice a month, sometimes several of them. And good or bad, some of the members have been on the board so long, it's basically it's very mechanical for us to know what we're doing. Whereas people, because we're on TV, we should explain much more on TV when we have these meetings, like, why are we doing this? What does this mean? What is site plan approval? We've got about, at least 15 special permits that we issue, or we're responsible for issuing at various times if somebody comes in. And while we know what it means, because for all intents and purposes, we've drafted most of them, but the vast majority of townspeople, I would bet, don't know what that means. And so we should be educating more at the beginning of the public hearings. What is this and why are we doing it? And sometimes, why did it come about? Most of our zoning bylaws are unfortunately reactionary. We've got a few that we've done before the horse got into the barn, but a lot of them we've had issues, and so we've tried to address the issues not to happen again or to regulate the issue so it doesn't get out of hand. I think Mr. Dwyer has something he wants to say too.
Hey, Bill Dwyer, also from the planning board. The one thing I wanted to stress is the planning board has operated without staff for the almost 30 years that I've been on it. And we have functioned because, particularly Jim and I, but the other members of the board pitch in when they can, have been able to carry out most of the functions. That is not a long-term plan for success. At some point, we are going to have to be looking at staff, which means money, which means different space allocations. Right now, we are at the senior center. We're not there during the day. We come in for our meetings, and that's fine, but at some point, there's going to another telephone line, another desk, another body, and it's coming down the road. It's not here now, not this year, not next year, but it is not going to be avoidable.
Thank you. Schools?
Hi, I'm Annie McKenzie, the superintendent. I'm speaking on behalf of the Hadley School Committee. So just quickly, because others have highlighted some of the statistics that speak to what the schools do. So we prepare students to contribute positively to a global society, prepare them academically, and we help to prepare or develop them as well social and emotionally. We provide rigorous academics, a wide array of extracurricular activities. We believe we provide a safe and supportive environment to help students develop socially and emotionally. And we also believe that we provide opportunities for students to participate in service learning and good citizenship. And some of the evidence that we've been pretty effective at this work is that your 2015 statewide standardized test scores for your Hopkins Academy, your school right here, 100% of your 10th graders, the first time they took the test, passed the test in English language arts. 98% of those students scored proficient or advanced. 96% of your students passed grade 10 mathematics the first time they took it, and of that 96%, 92% were in the proficient or advanced range. The class of 2014, which is the class for which we have state certified data, over 90% of those students, we had a greater than 95% graduation rate. Actually, it was 98% for that class. And over 90% of those students enrolled in post-secondary institutions immediately upon graduating, so they successfully got into colleges. The majority of them got into colleges of their choice. And the class of 2010, which would be the class for which we, the most recent class for which we would have this data, these data, when they get into college, about over 90% of them persist from year one into year two, and 75% of them obtain their bachelor's degree in 4 years, which compares with only about 50% in the state. So not only do we prepare students well for college, good news for you parents who are paying for college, we make sure they get out in 4 years. That's great news. So you're investing well in a wonderful, I think, set of services. And I just heard a school committee member say, yeah, so obviously kids in college. And also I want to talk about our students are not just academically gifted, but they're also great people. Our Hopkins Academy had the distinction of winning the District F. There are 8 districts in athletics in the state of, in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. And our students won the Sportsmanship Award for the entire District F. So Hopkins Academy, this little teeny tiny school, won the Sportsmanship Award for our district in this state. So we do believe that we're allocating resources well to meet those goals. And most recently this past year, your FY16 school department budget, after being reviewed by business managers from throughout the US and in Canada, received something called the Meritorious Budget Award for budget presentation, clarity of budget presentation, and aligning resource allocation with intended outcomes. So what things do we think would benefit in terms of facilities? What kinds of investments do we believe would benefit our students? We have a capital plan. Our capital plan can be found in our budget document, in some of our school committee packets, and is also available. I believe the town does have a copy of it, and we have it in our office. Some big investments. We would like to redo the athletic fields. The 2012 designs for the athletic fields for Hopkins Academy, that design estimated the cost at just shy of $1.3 million to do that. That would be for a complete redesign of the athletic fields, a track. There are many other pieces of that design. It's not solely just the fields. We also are interested in resurfacing our parking lot, this parking lot right out here. And we're estimating that cost to be somewhere around $200,000, but we would need to kind of go out for some sort of bid to get clear on what that actually would be. We have it in the capital plan at $200,000. We're interested in renovating our girls' locker room. We don't believe that it's up to par, and we believe our female athletes deserve the same treatment as our male athletes. In 2011, that was estimated to be a $400,000 expenditure. And we also would like to put in, or need to put in, must put in external grease traps in both of our schools, and that's about a $30,000 expense. There are other minor expenses. Well, minor is relative compared to those prices that I just gave you that are also included in our capital plan, but those are specific things that have to do with improving our facilities. and we believe that those investments will further enhance the educational experience of the students in Hadley. Thank you for listening to me.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, so we'll go into the town departments now. We'll start with the building services. Oh, sorry. Is the assessor with, are you going to talk for the assessor or?
I was going to represent all.
Well, all come on up.
And why is that, Tim?
They just asked me.
Why didn't they do it?
It was all compiled on the.
I know, but why didn't they do it?
All right.
So I'm Tim Neihardt, the billing commissioner in town. And so certainly my office is in the town hall. There are numerous offices there comprised into 12 rooms, measuring from 100 square feet, which is a room that's 10 by 10, up to the largest room, which is a little over 460 square feet. So in the town hall, we have the collector, the clerk, accountant, treasurer, assessor, the selectman, the town administrator and staff, board of health, conservation. We used to have planning board in there, but they're now in the senior center. ZBA, and we used to have veterans in there. So back last fall, the Municipal Buildings Committee asked for surveys, and I did send that around to everybody. If anybody wants it, we certainly can get that to them. It's an 8-page report, and it wasn't just for the town hall, it was for quite a number of the different departments throughout town, be it fire, police, DPW, and such. But one of the other things we wanted to do was to compile a space needs for the town hall itself. The town hall essentially is about 5,000 square feet. With that 5,000 square feet, 2,000 of it is really the halls and the stairs. So you're really looking at 3,000 square feet of office space. When we went through all the different departments with their requests and what they felt would they need for future space, we compiled a chart, and we have the chart. I think you guys have that too. So, and it was broken into different various needs. Meeting space, additional space for their offices, and quite honestly, a lot of storage space. So all that combined came out to about 2,800 additional square feet. For employees, the guesstimate was that because of technology these days, the hope is that the staff won't have to increase dramatically. So it was about two full-time people for staff, and about seven or nine part-timers. One of the things that I can say personally as in the inspector, I do miss having having the planning board directly across the hall. I think that has not worked well with them in a different building. Years ago when we were together, there was many times that they asked me to come over, and it worked back and forth, it worked well. So we do have this disconnect with putting departments into other buildings, and it would be nice to get these central services back under one roof. So what are some of the things that people really needed? Certainly, we only have one meeting space in the town hall. Years ago, we had more than the one, and I think there is still a great need to have more than one meeting space for all the different departments. One of the things that has happened is because we only have the one meeting space, now the different departments that used to come together in one night are now splitting into different nights because we only have the one meeting space. Again, if we had more meeting space, maybe some of the departments could be meeting at the same night. I think it would work a lot better for the town. One of the other crucial things that we do not have that is critically needed is private meeting spaces in numerous different departments. And there are times that people come in and there is no way of talking about personal things or things that other, certainly people don't want to hear, people hear about. And it is a problem in the town. We do have the one meeting space, but it isn't soundproofed. And some of the places really ought to be soundproofed. One is certainly the selectmen. They always go into executive session. Those are the things that really need to be looked at. Storage is a real problem right now in a lot of departments. One, a lot of them have to have specialized storage. We have one vault. A lot of people put the stuff in there, but a lot of this stuff is private that other departments and individuals should not be looking at. I think that needs to be addressed and increased. So for the town hall, that's about it. I know that Linda wants to come up and talk about her individual department, and the others might want to do the same. As far as mine, one of the things that Bill brought up was there's no staff for them. One of the things that we talked about many, many years ago was actually bringing on some full-time staff that would handle not just one department, but numerous of these departments that actually coincide together in some respects. Conservation, planning board, myself. Because all that stuff kind of interacts. We've also talked about that with the IT increase of IT technology that we're going to hopefully get in the town hall, because that's a huge, huge issue right now. There's a lot of us that seem to be doing things that we could do better, and that's being addressed by the selectmen, and that's really going to help. That's about it.
All right, thank you. Meyer?
No.
Alphabetical.
Oh, I thought she was part of town.
Go ahead. I was telling alphabetical.
I'll be brief because Tim covered this very well, but Tim mentioned that we'd like to have ability to meet privately with people. And I just want to say that it's not just a desire, it's really a need, particularly in the treasurer's office. We meet with employees about their medical issues, about when they're new employees, they're filling out forms, they're talking about their benefits. We handle workers' comp claims. We have meetings about unemployment hearings coming up. These are things that we have to keep confidential. And we have two of us working in an office, and we get ourselves in pickles a lot because one of us is taking in money from a department head and someone comes in and starts talking about something else. It's not always easy for us to slip that out and just go into the conference room next door, because maybe what we need is in the file cabinet in our office, or maybe what we need is on our computer. So we have some of those things to work out. And that's not just unique to our department. I think that some of the confidentiality issues are unique to our department, but I think all departments do have the need to be able to go away and into some private space. And as we're looking at the possibility, I don't know, as we're rearranging things in buildings, I would like to make sure that that is accommodated in future planning. Thank you.
Good. Fire. Well, if we do public safety, you're out of order again, but go ahead. Okay. No, come on.
You're a tag team, Mike and Mike.
M&M.
It's the Mike and Mike show. Good evening. I'm Mike Spangnable, resident of Hadley and also the fire chief. I was asked to come out tonight to discuss a little bit about what's been going on with the building needs assessment that the building committee has spent countless hours on. We've made a number of presentations in regards to our thoughts on the North Hadley substation. And basically, I will definitely keep it brief. A lot of you folks have probably heard it already. The opinion of myself as the fire chief, and I'm sure a lot of member or residents of the town of Hadley, the public safety building that was placed up in the North Hadley Hall was put there by some still current members and also past members of the fire department because of the need that was seen by past chiefs. A lot of our call force members, for you know, a little bit of statistics on what we have for a department, you have myself as a full-time chief, one full-time fire prevention lieutenant, and a part-time 15-hour per week office person. The rest of the department is call force department, so folks that work full-time jobs during the day and night, and that number right now is 22. So during the day, when I first started as a call force person, we had, I would say, three or four folks that worked in town, either, you know, at their own business or were members of the DPW, and they were responding as call force people when the call came in. Those days have changed now. Folks are working out of town. Folks have new families. Students are going off to college. They don't have the time to commit the extensive amount of training it takes to be a firefighter now. So what we do have is a bunch of very dedicated members who take the time when they come home after working a full day to go out at 2 o'clock in the morning for a structure fire or a medical or a car accident. And we have the north side of Hadley. So I've put together statistics that I presented in the past. So tonight I just want to tell you that I have just one statistic. We had, I'm sure you all saw in the news, the barn fire that we had in North Hadley. Engine 2, which is stationed in the north end of town, was the first truck to that scene because two call force members happened to be in the north side of town, and that truck beat every other truck that we have, including myself, and I responded as soon as the tone came out. That truck was critical in getting operations started, and I just wanted to say thank you to the wonderful people, the residents in town that actually helped set up that truck, some of them past members of the fire department who live in that area, who actually assisted the three of us who were trying to get water flowing into the truck and getting water onto that massive fire that was being wind driven by 40 plus mile an hour winds and getting ready to start numerous other buildings on fire. So that's what I have to say to you about my opinion. I've presented before, and I don't, you know, I've presented before about where we need to be housed. The structure you've all seen, the park and rec and the North Hadley station, is in disrepair. I've had in the capital plan for numerous years requests for funding to make updates and fix that section of the building. That's the decision of, we're relying on a very educated and well-versed board, the select board, to make that decision. However, I'm just a little bit concerned that I've been hearing that some folks don't feel that there's a need for it. Are there other options? Yes, there's other options that have been discussed with establishing a full-time fire department so that the truck can leave our center station and make it to that part of North Hadley in the same amount of time. We've put those statistics together too as to having a truck in the station. And the numbers are still showing, certainly we would get there, but we're not gonna be getting there as fast as we may be getting with folks that are still stationed in the north part of town. So that's my opinion. Chief Mason is here to discuss also the central station. So the newest building in the town of Hadley, which was opened in 1996. And basically we are functioning full time out of that building. I'll let him speak on the police side. We've just kind of outgrown the structure. So the structure is a 24/7, 365 days a year. It is open, operating, people in and out, nonstop. And that causes wear and tear. So we've been working extremely hard with call force members donating time, requesting funds from the town to repaint, to recarpet, and to try and keep it up as best as we can. However, we've outgrown the building. We have apparatus, as you've seen, I'm sure, driving by the station, that's parked out in the parking lot because we don't, there is zero space left in the structure. Unfortunately, we have water on most of our trucks, and it can't be out during the winter, and we don't like keeping all the equipment out during the summer. Not to say that we don't have a lovely, honest town, but there's a lot of expensive equipment on there that doesn't need to be beaten by the sun as well. So I'm going to pass it off the mic. My opinion is that the building committee is doing a great job leading towards how they want to mold this. I am not opposed to either A, building out the department that we're in right now so they can fit the needs. They also have some pretty interesting ideas about actually maybe repurposing the structure for other departments. So you have a structure that's there that could be repurposed for possibly Park and Rec and the Senior Center in a very good location, and then rebuilding a new public safety structure. You know, that's stuff that we need to talk about. Our only concern is because we've outgrown it, we're kind of in a holding pattern now. So the funds that we've requested to fix stuff and to expand our services, the priority personnel, so getting full-time staffing, we're responding to well over 700 calls for service at this time, from car accidents to structure fires, to medical calls, to seniors that have fallen. You name it, we've done it. Cats up in the tree, believe it or not, it does happen. So anyways, so that's where we're at. So we're just looking for the direction and the ability to make those corrections and expansions, because it's the time has come. You see how busy we are in the town of Hadley with Route 9. The number of inspections that we're doing and everything else is extensive. And I will pass it off.
So I'll be real fast. I could just say ditto and walk away. I do have to apologize. I am a little behind the curve. All of the work that the Municipal Building Committee did, I'm just starting to learn and see all the work that you folks put into that. Mike was actually just showing me that manual today of the expansions or the other ideas for repurposing or adding on to the public safety complex. Really, honestly, ditto kind of does it, because whatever happens to the building itself, I don't think it's any secret that the police and fire departments are intending to expand. Not our building, but our departments, our agencies. We feel that the expansions are absolutely necessary to provide the services that the town deserves. So while expanding your agency is certainly not divorced from expanding your living quarters, your building, it doesn't necessarily mean that you need a new one. So I'm certainly in favor of leaving it up to the experts to give us some direction of which way to go. But what I can say is I'm glad that that Jerry and the board put this together. Hearing where all the other departments are in town with their buildings, I mean, some of you make me want to give Mike's half of the building away immediately. Anybody who wants to move in. But in all honesty, we can do either. We can expand and do the things necessary to bring us to a point that we can exist in that same building. And if you want to build us a new one, I'm not going to say no to that either. But it's really right now, I'm glad this meeting was put together, because we just need some direction of which way to go. We're ready to do the work. We just need to know which way.
Thank you.
Hopefully we'll win the $1 billion tonight.
Yeah, did everybody buy their ticket?
I'll buy it.
Hi. Those of you who don't know me, I'm Richard Truswell, the station manager of Hadley Public Access Television, town's public access cable television station. First, I want to apologize to everyone for the PA system hiccups that we've had, and to the viewers watching, who had to put up with the buzz and the audio at the beginning of the meeting, and then we accidentally knocked ourselves off the air. Just one of those days. I'd like to introduce my new production assistant, Miranda Cottle. She's done a great job and has taken the load off of me. I was starting to go nuts trying to get everything done that needed to be done. Everyone hear me okay? As I'm sure that you know, HPAT's office is currently located in the basement of the Hadley Senior Center. HPAT's current office is an old classroom that is approximately 500 square feet in size, maybe a little larger. An ideal space for HPAT at this point would be a space that is at least twice as big as our current office is. The space would be made up of four rooms. One would be a private office for the station manager. One would be a small studio to shoot productions in. Another room would contain the station's head end and cable casting facility. Which is basically the automated cable caster and a few VCRs and whatever. We're one of the few stations that still broadcast occasionally from videotapes. But we're mostly digital now. And storage space for the station's television production equipment and DVD collection. The fourth room would contain several editing stations and workspace for a production assistant and perhaps a larger table for meetings and workshops. Of course, this plan is not set in stone. I plan to do some research on what the best layout would be for HPAT's office. As for a new permanent location for HPAT, I was thinking that the new library building or the new senior center building, if one is built, would be very good places for us to have our facility. What is more important right now is where HPAT's office would be located during the construction of a new library on the site of the Senior Center building, if that's the route the town decides to take. Because of the nature of HPAT's operations, we can't just pack up and move to another office space like, for example, the town clerk could. We have special needs, the most important of which is the need to have access to Charter's return feed cable, which is used to send our signal down to their Chicopee head end for distribution back up here to the Hadley Cable subscribers. This means we have to be located in the vicinity of the intersection of routes 9 and 47. The return feed cable could be extended by Charter, however, it would be done at the town's expense and likely would not be cheap. I have been thinking about temporary quarters for HPAT ever since Willie Danilico told me a couple of years ago that I would have to move out of my office at least temporarily when the building is eventually renovated, which was an option the Municipal Buildings Committee was looking at the time. My first thought for temporary quarters for HPAT was the copy room in the town hall. However, with all the IT equipment that is in there now that's been added within the past few months, there just simply is not enough space in there for us, even if the copy machine's moved out into the hallway. Also, with the IT equipment needing power, there would not be enough wall outlets for HPAT's equipment. Another possibility would be the town accountant's office in the town hall. The representative from the accounting firm is currently handling the town's, that is currently handling the town's accounting needs, is only using the office 10 hours a week. He could be relocated to a small room on the east end of the second floor of the town hall that most recently was used as an office for the town's Veterans Affairs agent. Another possibility would be my old fourth grade classroom in the basement of Russell School, which is about the same size as HPAT's current office and is a nice quiet spot in the building. Besides, the downsides of this location include the fact that the floor tiles have been removed, leaving exposed what is probably asbestos-laden mastic. Also, with the select board planning to, and probably I think they already have, mothball the building, the room would have no heat. We have an oil-filled space heater that we use to heat our current office before a new heating system was installed in the building. However, when it is going full blast, this space heater uses 1,500 watts of power. And I do not know if the wiring in that room could handle such a load. My guess is it cannot. Other than the above possibilities, I cannot think of any other place HPAT could go. There's no available space in Hopkins Academy, and the elementary school is too far away from the center of town. So temporary location for us right now is our biggest worry. And I think I've kept it under 5 minutes. So turn it over to whoever's next.
Thanks, Richard.
Thank you, Richard. Later. Okay, so we're going to save the, we've saved the best one for last. Come on up, Public Works.
Name is Michael Klamoski. I'm the acting DPW director for the town of Hadley. I'd just like to thank the Municipal Building Committee for the wonderful improvements that have happened at the DPW, including the roof, the installation for the ceiling, the new doors, the new overhead doors. That is saving the town a tremendous amount of money on heating. I mean, that garage was built in 1972, before I started, and hasn't had much improvements since then until the building committee took it upon themselves to add us to their list and to get some of these projects done. A few of the things that are most important to the building is at one time this was considered an emergency communication station, let's say, if we needed it, because we have power all the time. We have a standby generator that is in a sewer plant that can run both buildings, can run the highway department and also the sewer department and communications, and we're not even in the floodplain. So at one time it was considered as being an emergency communication part of the town of Hadley. As for the building needs, the building committee knows. I met with them. We talked about it. The space, of course, in every department is the issue. And in our department, the biggest space, of course, is the trailers. They were just supposed to be temporary trailers there for a short period of time. They've been there 10 to 12 years already. So they need to be replaced definitely. We have, again, no map rooms, no conference rooms, no training rooms, none of that stuff. We need the storage, which we don't have. We need, which was mentioned by the capital, by the Municipal Building Committee. We need a wash bay for the trucks. And just a few other little aspects. The sewer plant, which is right next to us, about expansion. It's not known what and when we will have to do that. It depends on how soon and how fast the sewer system grows in the town of Hadley. It was built in 1964 originally. And the water treatment plant, which is also very, very important to the town of Hadley. That was built in 2007. That should not need any help, any repairs, anything for the future, just a few minor upgrades, maybe some heating, ventilation, and computers. And if any of you don't know what the DPW does, we take care of the roads, the water, and everything else, the sewer lines, the trees. So that's about all I have. Thank you.
Thank you, Mike.
So, we want to public comments and see if you guys, okay. So we're gonna skip the select board talking to you and ask if there's anybody in the public who would like to come up and talk about their thoughts or views.
Are we gonna talk at the end?
We'll talk at the end. God, so is there anybody just in general who would like to say anything? Has any thoughts?
Ask questions?
Wow, really?
Presenters were amazing.
Can the selectmen talk now?
Yeah.
John. Come on. Mr. Edwards.
Come on up. Come up, please. We can hear you, but no one at home can hear you.
Good evening. My name is John Edwards. I'm a resident of the town of Hadley on Hawk Meadow Drive. I've lived in town for about 7 years, and I went to school at UMass and came to the Valley and never left. And I've worked in project management, and as an assessor of sorts, as an assistant assessor, and as an appraiser, a real estate appraiser. And I bring this up because it seems like the circular argument we continue to have is about money. And it's all about the money. And we have this blessing here Route 9. It's a wonderful tax base, and I think that if we're going to build and improve on what we have here for municipal services, municipal buildings, more staff, we need to find the money. And I don't know whether anybody's explored this, and I apologize for my ignorance if it's been explored, but why don't we consider the idea of a split tax rate in the town of Hadley that would shift some of the tax burden from residential to this beautiful tax base we have on Route 9?
Sure.
If you didn't, I could, but go ahead.
I personally would be very much against the split tax rate for the following reason. The business would go up probably by up to 50%, which is fine, but the residential tax rate would drop like a rock. That would make Hadley extremely attractive to developers, and you would see a housing boom in Hadley that would drive your tax rate out of sight for schools.
The other thing to worry about a split tax rate is you don't really change the base. You're only changing how you allocate the base. So the businesses get the bigger burden, while the property, house residences get a smaller burden. But so you don't really actually get any new revenue. You just change how you collect the revenue.
You still fall under Proposition 2.5.
So that's one of the reasons why you don't usually split your tax rate, or we don't split our tax rate.
Not that, only that discussion. But it makes it attractive for businesses to come here, and that's one of the reasons why they're successful for where they are. I mean, there are a few empty stores now over at the Hampshire Mall, which they're trying to remedy that problem over there, but that's what keeps our tax rate as low as it is. Not if we didn't have a lower tax rate and they didn't benefit from it, the businesses wouldn't come here.
But from a process standpoint, just so you know, John, that is something that every year is addressed with the select board. The tax assessor comes in and there's a discussion on it. It's not to say that at some point in time we may rethink that, but just so you know, we are thinking about that on an annual basis, and comment is always welcome in that regard.
No, I'm not surprised.
Yeah.
All right, so the board had some, I think, some questions are over here.
John Michkowski has his hand.
Oh, sorry.
John Michkowski on the planning board. I'm a former sewer commission. My question to the water commissioners and sewer commissioners, namely the selectmen, what are you doing with the infrastructure? I know when we were on a sewer commission, we contracted Time Bond to put a master plan for the sewer. This board is way behind schedule on what is scheduled to do to the sewer, and that didn't even touch the infrastructure. And the reason that the infrastructure wasn't done in that master plan, because we were to camera all the entire sewer lines. Sewer lines, some of them are self-destructing by the gases, and it could end up in millions of dollars in repairs. When a line collapses, that means you dig it up. A lot of this could be prevented with sleeves. We've done that in the past. Now the sewer, you have the same thing with drainage all over the town. The town's a flat town. There is nothing that has been really done to get rid of the water and dispense the water. There's more buildings coming in. There's more water being shed off. And our drinking water system, there's countless valves that should be exercised on a yearly basis. They're not. There's countless of valves that don't even work. They're frozen. And I want to know, you know, you talk about all these buildings, but you don't talk about the things you can't physically see. When it hits you, and I'm talking the sewer line, when it hits you, it's not going to be $100,000, $200,000, and they just experienced Lorana Drive with a small collapse, cost $250,000 to fix. This town is going to be hit with a major, major catastrophe in the sewer system if nothing is done. We started with the camera system. Somehow they lost everything we did. Now all of a sudden they found it. But that was 8 years ago. And what were they supposed to do is come back, whether it was 5 years or 10 years, and re-camera the thing, and then you can evaluate the deterioration of the lines. None of that has been done. And I want to know from this board, when do you intend to wake up and do something about it?
John, I'd be happy to respond to that. I'd be happy to respond to that. The focus of the meeting tonight was very clearly to address building concerns, but I agree with your points about the fact that the infrastructure can't be lost in the equation. And as part of the overall budget process and the overall overview of the capital planning process, infrastructure is an absolutely critical component to that. I think the only reason you didn't hear Mike Klimoski talking about it tonight is because the focus of the meeting was centric to buildings. But you will be hearing a lot more about that as we move through this budget process, and your comments are not lost at all. I think they're on point in many regards.
Just so you know, we have been, we just replaced two lift stations. We're getting ready to do a water line replacement on Route 9, and we're talking about doing some upgrades at the plant itself, which is the clarifier. So we are doing a lot. If we actually talked about everything we have to do here, we'd be talking about even more money. So that's why we kind of restricted this to just talking about kind of buildings right now. It's just a piece of the pie, and there's more of the pie we have to deal with as we go along. So does the select board have anything they wish to add to this?
Well, I do. I mean, welcome to our world, ladies and gentlemen. We're talking about what now? $75-100 million worth of projects that we're talking about there. That's a town with a budget, annual budget of between $15-16 million. So there's a huge need out there, and we wanted everybody to have the opportunity to sit in one room so that everybody, instead of speaking individually at different meetings and at different agendas, that everybody sat down and understood what everybody else's needs were. Certainly the libraries worked and gone forward and received some plans on that. Certainly the senior center is concerned regarding where are we going with our building. The town of Hadley's growing and the needs are growing, and we're seeing it each and every day. We're talking about it from Richard's department to Timmy's department to town hall to libraries to fire stations and the police departments. And we just want everybody to understand where it is when we're coming from. And we're going to just need to sit down and develop a plan. And we're trying not to scare everybody, because this isn't a two-year plan. We're not coming back in 2 years telling you that your taxes are going to triple because these projects need to be done. We need people to work together to understand that this has to be a phased-in system. We have to use common sense with it. I hear constantly every day about how, where are we with the buildings committee? Where are we with the buildings committee? Well, each and every door that opens a magnitude more of issues that we need to look at and address. And we need to put together a plan that takes care of the entire town, not everybody individually. So thanks for helping us work on it. Please understand we are working on it. And now can you understand the magnitude of what we're actually looking at? To the taxpayers at home that are sucking on pistols because they're looking at the amount of money that's gonna take to get this done, you know, please understand that, you know, that this is what we're trying to accomplish. We understand the needs, we're prioritizing the needs, and we're going to come out and work together to develop a plan. Thanks, everybody, for coming tonight. We really, really appreciate you coming. We wish even more people were here tonight from the different committees that could offer more information to us as well. But
so, Ms. Keegan?
Echo Jerry's sentiments. Thank everybody for showing up tonight. And I think another great thing about everybody being in the same room is just to remind everybody that we are neighbors. Each and every one of us. And it's easy, you know, in the budget seasons, the way that they've gone, to, you know, unfortunately get the feeling that we're all kind of pitted against each other and people are vying for the same precious dollars. Unfortunately, we're going to have to look at this in somewhat of a triage manner, I guess is the best way to put it. I mean, there are some people that are in far more dire need than others. And I think it's nice to hear people come to the microphone and say, okay, you know, we have definitive needs, but we can probably get by. But depending on how the buildings fall here is going to I don't mean literally fall, although that could be the case.
Could be the case.
Depending on how the decisions are made relative to a new building going up, potentially something being torn down, something being preserved. Right, I want to throw that in there for our historical commission, that, you know, there is going to be somewhat of a domino effect. So again, people understanding each other's needs is critically important. And I think the other thing I'd like to point out, too, is that during, you know, as we're sitting here tonight and we're talking about space needs, of course we're talking about capital. We're talking about an outlay of significant dollars. But there's also an operational budget impact that needs to be taken into account. And in some regards, I'm hoping and very hopeful that the operational impact could actually be a beneficial one, meaning that we're spending a lot of money heating, maintaining, you know, repairing with some of these older buildings. And sometimes you need to make an upfront investment to reap an ongoing reward. And I don't want that to get lost in translation here as well. So that's something that's going to be critically important for all of us to take into account as we move through the budget season as well.
I just like to thank everybody for coming, and I think this is a time for us to realize what every department is facing. It gives everybody here a chance to hear what everybody else has to say, and it gives the people at home a chance to hear what's going on also. And the realization of it all is that money has to be spent. And I think for a long time that we've avoided this problem, and nobody has ever wanted to spend that extra dollar on these old buildings. And now it's time for people to really think about this and really look at our needs and how we want to go for the future. I might not be here in 10 years. Who knows where anybody's going to be in 10 years, but we have a lot of students that live here in town that always migrate back to Hadley, even if sometimes they move to Boston, they always come back this way because they like Hadley. And I think in order for them to have a future here, we need to look at it today and see what we're going to have in Hadley for the coming years.
So I just want to thank everybody for coming. I like to kind of get a feel when I'm at some meetings like this, and so I'm going to ask you a question, and you can just answer. I'll say whoever's in favor can raise your hand. But we hear a lot about protecting the center of town, and that the Russell School is very important and a very important historic piece and a very, very important just anchor piece for the center of town. So does most people in the room agree that, you know, trying to save the Russell School for some other use is probably one of our important things? If you'd raise your hand, I'd appreciate it.
Yeah.
The other thing I hear, thank you.
Yeah, I'd like to make a comment on that in a minute.
Okay, I'll let you. So the other thing I also hear is that it's very important to keep all our services more centrally located in the center of town. There's been discussion that maybe we'd move some pieces a little bit farther out of the center. I always tell people I'm going to downtown Hadley, and they ask me where that is. And I say it's where Town Hall and the Donut Man is. But is it important to people to try to keep our services located in the center, where the current senior center is and the current town hall and this school? Is that important to people? If yes, raise your hand. If it's not that important, raise your hand.
Yeah.
Not Granby.
No, the center of town to me is between West and East Street.
I think it depends a little bit on the
services. Services, right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know if you were against it, Guilford, when I had made the comment of the non-binding ballot questions, but that's what you just did with this little survey. So now we have 50 or 60 people in a room that voiced their opinion. But now there's 200 other people at home that don't have that same chance. Well, and if we put a non-binding ballot question on a ballot, and we have 500 people that give us a little bit more direction on where we should go with these buildings, specifically, do you want a full-time ambulance service? Do you want to move the town hall to Russell School? Specific questions, non-binding question that we can get a general consensus of the direction this board needs to go in and the Municipal Building Committee needs to go in. And I think it's very important for our community to do this.
So I'm going to take John's statement one step further. We actually cannot put a ballot question on this upcoming ballot because we're restricted by law to do that. So we do have an election coming up, and I'll talk about that in a little bit. But anybody who's listening, this is a public hearing, and public hearings, there's a time for comment. So anybody who's listening, anybody who's here and wants to talk to somebody when they get home, make comment. You can make email comments, or you can call comments in, or write letters in and tell us what you think.
Or contact any one of us on the board.
So what Mr. Wiskevich said is very important. If we hear, we need to hear a little more. We are grappling with a question, and there's a lot of money at stake here. And we hear little bits here and there and little bits, but we don't hear a concerted voice from anybody saying, this is really how we feel it should be. Do we think, like, truly, do we think we need an ambulance service? We're listening to our neighbor next door saying they're stretched thin, but they're also our ambulance service. We're listening to the fact that we need to do another station in North Hadley. Do we need to do a North Station North Hadley, or do we need to do an ambulance service? Those are kind of questions. Do we need to have a senior center in the center of town? If you've heard what people said here, people at home are hearing what people are saying here. You have a comment, send it in. It's not going to be ignored. So we really do appreciate people sending in the comments. And even those here, if you have something a couple of days, a week later, write it and send it in to us. Let us know.
Could you ask them if, when we did the elementary school and I was on that committee, we sent out a survey. We sent out three different designs on how people would feel about what type of elementary school they would like to have. That was the most successful thing we did because we grappled with that for a long time. Would anybody feel like we should do a survey with important questions? And a mailing would certainly be worth it if we could get, you know, everybody to answer those questions. I think we would get a better feedback than, you know what, sometimes if you have people going to the polls, we don't sometimes get a good turnout. And at least we would be hitting every household.
It's a good question.
I just got a question about, you did send a survey. What was your response to that?
You got great feedback, didn't you, for the survey, for master plan?
Master plan.
The original one was fantastic.
You guys got great service for the master plan. A library.
As the lucky chairman of the co-chairman of the building committee that built the elementary school, what it was a survey that was sent out to all the towns, all the townspeople. And then what we had was I guess you call it an election. We held, I want to say, over the course of a week, John, we held, at certain times of the day, we had it at the town hall, and I think we even had it in one of the, might have been in Hopkins, I don't remember how many places we had it, where people could come in and one vote per registered vote, actually one vote per registered voter, and the building committee was checking the people off as you turned in the ballot. And you put it into a ballot box that was sealed, so we didn't know what you said, but it was vote for one of the choices of the schools. And for the master plan, I wasn't on that committee. Joe Zagradnik was at the time. But what happened with that one was they sent out a survey to the entire town. You mailed it in, you turned it in, whatever it may have been, for a multi-page survey, and that both the elementary school and the master plan got extremely good response, and the results were put into the master plan, and the results of the school was the school you see built today.
Do we want to do another survey?
If we get nothing else out of this meeting other than the fact that that's a great idea, I think it's a great idea.
Right. I would still argue, however, and not sound like a broken record, but I will.
Geez, I didn't even have to say that.
That surveys may need to be put in context, and if we're not providing the people responding to the survey with the context in which the questions are being asked, meaning there's only a certain amount of money, this is what our budget projections look like, I would still be in favor of conducting some sort of public forum to educate everybody on where we actually stand in town with finances before sending out a survey. I'm not opposed to a survey, but I think we need to do both.
But just even the questions he asked here tonight, would you like, what would you like seen done with the Russell School building? demolish or rebuild, I mean, or sell.
It's a simple, so, leave them as simple as possible.
You know, three things, if we could just get, you know, a committee to do that. I know we're talking about another committee, but I mean, we just need certain questions to be on that survey to go out to everybody.
So I think we have an item for another agenda next week.
Yeah, now let's talk about it more.
So are all of these people here that have issues going to be addressed in that one survey?
No, because you can't address all the issues in one survey, no.
Well, I mean, you could generalize it, you know, a community center for seniors. Would that be what somebody would like? We would work on those questions.
And the municipal building survey, certainly by Bob, or assistance in starting to formulate some of those questions.
That would be great.
You're more than happy to do that.
Certainly one issue remains at the forefront, at least in my mind, and that is the question about public safety. It's a legitimate decision.
Yes.
Which path we're going to go. And there's a number of different surveys that the chiefs have provided a lot of information. This has been going on for quite some time. And as we know, sometimes you wait long enough that survey or professional review that we had a few years back becomes dated. So, I mean, if you're down to a popular vote, you know, let's explore that at least so we can make it. It's a big decision for the town, but it's one that's critical and going to have an effect on where, at least.
In that very recent master plan, there was a lot of good information there, not a questionnaire, and you can read a lot into what people were looking at. Mm-hmm. And I think through that master plan, a number of these questions have been answered, but we could certainly increase the number of people that hope.
I agree, Tim. I think that master plan, that should be the first focus before we go out doing another survey.
Okay, so I don't think the survey alone is enough, though, because people want to know how much it's going to cost.
Right.
You can say, you want a public safety complex, but how much is it?
Yes.
You know, it's $5 million, $10 million. That can sway them one way or the other.
Do you want us to explore a new safety? Do you want us to explore a community center?
We can do that, but we do have to get information going out.
Where do people want to have us start? Give it to Lloyd.
On the very back.
Great job, guys. First, I want to say the departments in town have been phenomenal. Every time we've had involvement with the fire department, the police department, the EPW, they've been fantastic. I've Gary Ritter from Old Mountain Road. It's a dirt road. They take great care of it. But what you're asking for is a lot of money. As you just pointed out, this town's getting older, closer to fixed incomes. I'm in that same ballpark. I can't see this kind of tax increase. We've got to get creative here. We want to put in a book repository. Why not put a library attached to it and work with our private sector and work with our community in town and the businesses in town to help us build these things and work with us on these things and use the facilities that we have here. There's abandoned space. There's a lot of empty space in town. There's a lot of ways to utilize that space. I love shiny new buildings. I work for UMass now. And look what we're building over there. We got a whole, what we call a city within a town over there. But we need to partner with all these people if you want to develop these things, because you're not going to be able to come up with that kind of money, $75, $80 million in a town this small. It's just not going to happen. So we've got to get realistic here. Find more creative ways to do things. So that's what I have to add.
Thanks. Mr. Miskowski.
Yeah, I think your survey is a great idea. But if you don't have how it's going to affect your tax, everybody says, yeah, I want a new library, I want a new fire station. I don't want my taxes going up. How are we going to build it?
That's correct.
Associate your question with tax.
Yep.
Because that's who's going to vote for it is the taxpayers. And if they can't afford it, they're not voting for nothing. You can wish to the cows to vote, you're not going to get anything.
But I think that
what actual cost in it? Because every time something came forward to this town, and I'm talking way back, 50 years, 100 years, they were conservative, hardworking people, but those people knew what it was going to cost before they voted for it. Not just a big wish list.
Well, it would give us a chance to prioritize.
Just what I'm telling you about that infrastructure.
Yeah. I know.
You guys are off base.
I know.
Really?
We're always
off. Yeah, to reinforce some of that, that the master plan, the revised updated master plan we're working on had a lot of some of these questions on it about the senior center. And of course, you know, preservation of land was obviously number one, a few of the other very common ones, but there was a lot of interest in senior center and senior activities. The missing link was exactly that. There was no cost associated with it. And when people find out what the cost is and what it'll, how it'll affect their pocketbook, and you know, the old devil's in the real details here, changes a lot.
Yep. Well, and it's not just cost, Jim. I mean, it is cost, but there are also trade-offs, because there are only a finite number of ways to resolve an issue. You either find new revenue, either in the form of getting creative with private enterprise or increasing the tax revenue, or you wind up having to make a very difficult decision on how to reduce some services. And all of that, I think, has to be on the table, again, put in front of people in a very constructive manner so that they can respond fully informed when a survey is put in front of them. So that was my point to this. So we need to figure out how to do it. We're not going to solve it tonight.
So with that, this is actually a select board meeting. We have two items of business to take care of. And you're welcome to stay and watch us, or you may leave.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming.
What do we have to do tonight? That wasn't on the agenda. I didn't get any agenda.
Everybody, don't forget to vote on Tuesday, too. We have the overrides.
I didn't get any agenda.
Was that on?
Yep. January 19th, yeah, polls open at noontime.
Are you still on, Richard?
No, I know.
Okay.
I had a meeting at
So, are you guys ready?
No.
You guys ready?
Yeah.
All right. So we have the consent agenda. We have just the consent items, some liquor license and stuff. All right.
So I just made a motion to approve.
Not for pride.
Approve the consent agenda as presented.
Okay, we have a motion to approve the consent agenda.
So moved.
Not tonight, though.
Second?
No, you're not on tonight.
Okay.
They're on in February.
All those in favor of the consent agenda?
Aye.
I'm good. I think I'm good with everything on this one.
You are.
Okay.
Did you vote, John?
He did.
He voted.
Vote
all.
Yes. Yes.
He said yes.
What else?
Is that it?
Actually, I have an announcement, but I don't need people to read it. It's too loud.
I think we're
for the override. I forgot about that.
Oh. Richard, how's the sound for home right now?
Just put it on TV.
I'm waiting.
Okay.
Okay, so the last item we have on the agenda is to remind people to go to the polls and vote for the override. The election is...
Thank you for coming.
I can't stand up to the senior center.
Thank you.
Thank you. When's the election?
It's the 19th. From noon to 8.
12 to 8.
Okay.
No, noon to 8. Yeah, 12 to 8.
Noon to 8.
Noon to 8.
So remember the override. We're voting for a school bus, $140,000. There's a dump truck for highway, a backhoe for highway, and a backhoe for highway. So that's it. Make sure you come and vote.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor? Aye.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Good night, everybody.
Good night.